Welcome, everyone. This is the school board meeting of March 16th, 2016. The reason I am introducing the meeting is technically we do not have a chair, a vice chair, or other officers for the ensuing year. Our elections were last week, and we're pleased to say that the school budget was passed wonderfully, with a high plurality of voters. And our veteran board members were reelected. So our business tonight is to elect a chair. So I open the floor to nominations for chair. Maria?
I would nominate Tom Newkirk for chair.
Is there a second for Tom?
I will second.
All right. And are there any other nominations? Seeing none, I close nominations and call for a vote. All those in favor of Tom as chair? Unanimous of those present?
I'll abstain.
Oh, okay. Tom abstain. He's still chair, even though you abstained. So I'll turn the gavel over to you, Tom.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks to the board members for your confidence in me. I thought it was just a fantastic board to work with last year. I think we worked through hard stuff and did it well. So I look forward to working with all of you.
Could you try for that?
Okay. Thank you. That was the gist of it. We have opened the board for nominations for vice chair. Al, I don't know if you want to maybe speak to that.
Well, I'll actually make a motion to nominate Denise Day. I think since I've picked up another entire board that I'm working on, it'd be wise to have somebody else who's really thoughtful take over.
Maria?
My second.
I just like to think Denise will be fabulous. You know, I think she's been a fantastic board member, tremendously involved in the community. Do your homework, always come prepared. I think it'd be fantastic to work with you as vice chair. Okay, any further discussion? All those in favor, please raise your hand.
I will abstain.
Six in favor, one abstention. Student rep is in favor. Okay. So, Denise? Okay, we get a...
I'll switch sides with you.
You're going to be able to do it. I'm just going to have to go up and circle each other.
Yeah. Okay.
Don't forget your name.
So the next thing we need to do is to review policies BDB and BBAB. And in looking through those, they're not consistent. And one policy, BDB, prohibits the chair from originating or seconding motions, and policy BBAB gives that right to the chair. So I think that probably is work for the policy committee to resolve that. And my own sense, you know, maybe my sense is that it's often unwise for the chair to be originating motions, but whether that should be a right that the chair should have, you know. I think maybe the policy committee could work that out. But I think one way or the other, it needs to be consistent. Other comments about those two policies? Okay, I'll consider those reviewed. We have the election of officers. So if you move down to actions,
Could we
what?
Welcome?
I'm sorry. Well, the election, okay. According to the board, that's next, but I think maybe we'll move to welcome the student representative, Troy LaPlease. Welcome.
Thank you.
And you're a lacrosse player, a junior?
Yep.
Any more biographical information you'd like to provide us?
NHS, I was vice president of the sophomore class last year. And then this year I'm doing this, NHS, varsity lacrosse, and varsity basketball.
Okay.
And he's interested in environmental science.
Uh-huh. Great. You're sitting next to the right person.
Right.
So welcome. As I've explained to you, I think before the meeting started, you're invited to vote on every motion that we have before us, unless it's a meeting that you did not attend, say, as a non-public, and you're welcome to speak. So if you have comments about some issues, and like to say your perception and share perceptions you think that students have on these issues, feel free to do that. Okay. We'd welcome that.
Thank you.
Okay, to move to the election of officers, could I have a motion to elect William Leslie as the school district clerk? Denise?
I'd like to make a motion to elect William Leslie as school district clerk.
Moved by Denise Day, seconded by Dan. Is there discussion on that? No, all those in favor, please raise your hand. 6 in favor, student rep abstains. Motion to elect Lisa Harling as Oyster River School District Treasurer. Denise?
I'll motion to elect Lisa Harling as School District Treasurer.
Moved by Denise, seconded by Al. Discussion? All those in favor, please raise your hand. 6 in favor, student rep abstains. Motion to elect Katie Lilly as the School District Physician. Denise?
I'll motion to elect Dr. Katie Lilly as School District Physician.
Moved by Denise, seconded by Dan. Discussion? All those in favor, please raise your hand. 6 in favor, the student rep abstains. I think that's all the election of officers. So to move forward to public comment, could I have a show of hands how many people would like to speak in public comment? Good. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 13. Okay, what I'll do is I'll allow each person 2 minutes. That'll give us about 25, 26 minutes of public comment. So this way we can get you all in this part of the meeting, but we're gonna limit you to 2 minutes. So if you wanna just take a look at your comments, make sure they fit within that. I hate to cut people off, but if you start running over, I will do that, okay? So introduce yourself.
I'm Dean Rubine from Lee, and I will be brief and not mention football. I just wanted to congratulate the board and the district on a wonderful election. Congratulations to Tom Newkirk for being reelected, and to Kenny Rotner, who apparently is already shirking. No, you guys are sentenced to 3 more years of hard labor, and we appreciate it. Congratulations to all of you who worked so hard to get the field, especially the assistant superintendent and athletic director. And congratulations on the budget.
Thanks, Dean.
David Taylor from Durham. I want to echo what Dean just said. Congratulations to Tom and Kenny and the budget and a full day kindergarten, but also particularly Fort people who have been working for God knows how long, decades, to try and get this field passed and the track passed, and they finally got it. And Todd and the folks, really great job. Kathy O'Brien, I think, led the effort, and it was really wonderful. It's great to see that done. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Adam Stewart. I'm from the 7th grade at Oyster River Middle School. I live in Durham, and I'm here to touch upon the football. I've been playing football since I was 7 years old in the 2nd grade. While many of you believe there's a risk to playing football, have you even thought about the benefits? Improved health and weight control, believe me, we train pretty hard. Over my 5 years of playing, I've learned the value of teamwork, selflessness, how to control my emotions, and how to overcome fear. Football's a game of discipline and practice. I've learned the importance of preparation and hard work. Football's about being part of something greater than yourself. It's about learning rules and boundaries and listening to coaches. I trust my teammates. We're a family. I've learned over the years how to win with respect and how to deal with losses and disappointments. Please don't take all of this away from me or my teammates. Let us, along with our parents, make the final decision. We understand the risks and appreciate you trying to keep us safe, but please let us make the decision if it's right for us. Come the fall of my freshman year, without football, I will not have any sport to play. I can't pick up soccer or any other spring sport, or fall sport, excuse me, as a freshman and be successful. I'm a football player. I'm asking, just about begging you, not to take this opportunity away from us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Teresa Brady, and I am from Madbury. I am here to hope and pray that you pass the cooperative football program with Portsmouth. My son loves football. He has spent 4 years of his life learning how to team build with his team. He has gone so far as to start his own business because he has so much confidence from football. He's had a business for 2 years now. Football is his life, and I think it's very unfair that my son doesn't have the chance to play what he loves. All the kids in the school district, everybody wants to give them everything except football. Football is my choice to let my son play. Not somebody else, not a doctor, not a teacher. It's my choice. I want my son to play football. I can't afford to move out of the district. And I think it would be a great thing for our children to have this co-op in order to pursue what they want. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Jake from Barrington, and I've played football since I was 6 years old, and it is a very big part of my life. I've played at Dover for several years, but Oyster River, I've tried this year to start to know people before attending high school. Oyster River football players I've met are through third through eighth graders, and the ones that I've played with the past year love the game as much as I do. We worked well as a team, and with all our hearts, we love this game. Through football, I've learned so many things about leadership, respect, and motivating others, working as a team, and to respect more of myself. I am a strong student and a good athlete, and would really like to attend the Oyster River High School, but not having an opportunity to play football would impact the decision. There are many students in Barrington, including friends of mine, that love to play football. This co-op with Portsmouth would be a great opportunity for both the current students and potential students looking to attend Oyster River. Thank you.
My name is Gabe Goodwin, and I am 11 years old, and I go to the Oyster River Middle School, and this is my first year playing football, but instantly, I love football. It's a great sport, and I feel that it's an amazing way to, like, let your energy out. And for me, it's helped me overcome a lot of things. Like, it's helped me with grades because a lot of the time I would, like, get, like, really, like, I'd not do very well, and, like, football has really changed that because it's, like, told me to, like, kind of, like, try harder and, like, do much better. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name's Ariette Fizek. I'm from Lee, New Hampshire, and attend Oyster River Middle School. I'm a little new to this football thing, only started last year, but I myself love this game, and I'm proud to be here and playing. The team is supportive, and I think football is not just fun, but a good learning experience as well. I learned to be more confident, a leader, and to be more respectful and less on the rude side. I consider it an honor, and you bet I'll be doing this next year if I get the chance, for as long as I can. And thank you.
Thank you.
I'm Noah Willette. And this is my friend and fellow teammate, Andre LaFleur, Joe Brady. We've been playing football together for several years. We've developed great friendship and appreciation for each other. We're team leaders. We recognize our role in helping younger players develop and grow. We value the bonding that comes from working hard as a team. As it stands now, our team is done unless we seize our opportunity to form the co-op with Portsmouth High School. That makes us upset. Why should we as football players not have this opportunity to continue together? We urge you to move forward on this matter tonight. We have been in limbo for a long time. We deserve the same consideration you have afforded other students who play other sports. Thank you for your time and consideration.
Thank you.
Hello, I'm Andre LaFleur, and I've been playing in the Oyster River football program for 5 years now, and it has really changed my life. It has taught me to work hard with other kids and work as a team to complete a goal that we all have in common. It has taught me confidence. I now know how to speak up and give my suggestions for other ideas and practices in games and even in real life. Each year playing football became more fun for me as the program attracted more and better players into the program every season. We built on success and won 2 championships. The coaches made it less dangerous and really showed us the proper techniques and correct ways to do things so no one gets hurt. Football is really special to me. I've been playing it for so long now, and I would really like to continue, and I hope you guys decide to let us have it. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Joseph Brady. I'm here to tell you why we should have football with Portsmouth. I've been playing football since 4th grade, and I'm now in 8th. Football gives me something to look forward after a long day at school. It encouraged me to give my best at everything. In a way, football showed me how to set goals. Like when I came into 5th grade, I was so behind on my reading level, but I finally got there this year because I worked so hard. I kept good grades to play football. Football also gave me the self-confidence to go start my own little landscaping business. Football has helped me make friends over the years. I play with some of the nicest people I know. It helps get the anger out and keep me in shape. If it wasn't for football, I wouldn't be as fit as I am now. When I play football, nothing else matters. It's my escape. Football not only affects me on the field, but it affects me in life. It has made me who I am.
Thank you.
Not as short as they are. Krista Butts, and I still live in Lee, as I have for the last 18 3/4 years. These are my boys, Tyler and Kyle, and they don't want to speak on camera because they don't want to be on video. Just don't tell them that they're still on video. I am here to tell you today that these boys and girls who have spoken before you, by the way, you guys let the hockey team speak for 31 minutes and 24 seconds at the last meeting, and there were exactly 13 speakers. So thank you for letting all of these guys speak as well. And yes, I did watch the timer to make sure that we were gonna get the same amount of time allotted for these boys and girls that you did for the girls' hockey program. And I think you've heard today that these kids have a passion for a game. They have a passion for a game that keeps them active, engaged in school, and it teaches them teamwork, leadership, and responsibility. Things that I have heard, because I played football in high school as a powder puff on a girls' team, but from other boys and girls that have played football in competitive leagues in high school and in college, you learn things on the football field that you never learned before. Actually, I spoke to an ORCSD administrator earlier today who played football in high school, locally here, and said that out of all the sports that he played, football is the one that taught him the most. I beg for you to give these kids the opportunity to continue that into high school, and I promise you that me as a mom, these guys' parents as well, we're not gonna go away. We want this for our children because they want to play. So if you refuse the Portsmouth co-op, we won't go, it's not gonna make us go away. We're still gonna want football for our kids. So it's up to you as to how you want to do that. Thank you.
Hi there, I'm Michelle Dunbar from Madbury. I have four children in the district. I'm going to read a letter from my fifth grader, Britton Dunbar, fifth grade at middle school. I've been playing hockey and lacrosse for a long time. Sometimes I get bored of it. This fall, I started playing football because it is very fun to watch. And I did not need to play only hockey and lacrosse. I loved it, even though we only won a few games. My favorite part of football is catching and running the ball. I hope I get to play football in my future, hopefully in high school. As a mom, I'll piggyback onto this. I played football myself in elementary school in Indiana. I love the game. I think in every high school in our state, we offered football in the fall, as well as other teams, other sports. I think even here at Oyster River, we have hockey and basketball in the winter, and in the spring we have baseball, and we have Help Me Out Here lacrosse, which my son plays. I'd like to see football as an option for these high school kids. And if we're going to think about safety, believe me, I've seen tons of hockey games. I see tons of kids on the ice. I see my son on the football field. I have seen him on the ground. I see soccer games. I see kids on the ground. I think we, as a community, are very serious about safety of football, and that will be a constant improvement as we go on. But I really believe that the benefits outweigh the risks, and I would like for you to vote yes for the cooperative with Portsmouth. This is our only option here for these boys coming in as freshmen. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Willie Willette from Durham, student athlete, parent, and coach. And I've been pursuing the football co-op program since the beginning of November. And you've been discussing it for some time now, too. And poor Corey here has been run ragged providing you with details and minutia. And I'd like if we could deal with the big picture, the concept, rather than getting bogged down in all the small stuff. Because nothing is perfect, and we can deal with the small stuff as they arise. I'm requesting that you make a motion tonight for a vote on pursuing the co-op program with Portsmouth. And I would request that you would vote in the affirmative on that vote. Our kids need this opportunity to continue their football endeavor. It's a sport they love, and we, as parents, care greatly for them and wouldn't allow them to be bullied or somehow not have a positive experience. Our coaching philosophies are similar with Portsmouth, and I would ask that you make the motion tonight and make a vote on it tonight. We don't need to mess around anymore. Thank you.
Thank you. Bob?
I prepared this for 3 minutes because I thought I had 3 minutes. Should I cut it, try to cut it down?
I think to be fair, yes.
Well, there's already been over 10 minutes of positive. This is negative, but whatever you want to do. As a citizen and physician, I oppose the proposal, which obviously in the near future is intended to be expanded upon. Here we are redoing the athletic fields primarily to address issues of safety, and you're about to approve a program which will increase injuries to students, most importantly, permanent brain trauma, or CTE. 94 of 100 brains of football players microscopically examined for CTE have been positive. 10% of those played high school football only. An NFL-funded report concluded that high school football not only has the highest rates of concussion, but also that the average high school player is twice as likely to suffer a brain injury as a college player. The National Academy of Sciences study confirmed this. and also that the latest helmet technology does little to prevent brain injury. The problem is not skull fracture, but acceleration, deceleration. The skull abruptly stops and the brain keeps going at 20 miles per hour, smashing against the bony skull. As players become bigger and faster, concussion incidents and permanent brain damage have and will continue to increase. One half of all reported sports concussions occur in football. Subsequent concussions increased by 39% the incidence of catastrophic head injury, leading to permanent neurologic disability. A Wake Forest School of Medicine study demonstrated before versus after season MRI brain changes in high school football players, even in players who did not suffer clinical concussion. Heaviest hitters exhibited the most brain changes versus light hitters. Today, the NFL has a huge problem it cannot solve. We don't need that problem.
Bob, your time's up, so you want to finish?
We have
the letter, too.
Okay. Give me about 15 seconds, just the last couple.
You have it. Okay.
After viewing the film Concussion, a Pittsburgh high school football star recently wisely turned down 12 scholarship offers, some from first division schools, never to play football again. In the early 70s, when I was involved in ORYA, the question of football occasionally arose. The consensus then was that this community would never be dumb enough to adopt it. That apparently remains to be seen.
Okay. Brian Cisneros from Durham. I played football my entire life, started in high school, played through college, played center pro football until I was 40, which is easily 5 years too long than my body should have. I didn't suffer anything that these doctors claim. My wife may think I'm crazy, but I'm perfectly fine, no issues, besides getting old. So this is a great opportunity. We're on momentum here. Matter of fact, I played with your dad, Troy, so many years. So I remember when you were this high coming to watch us. But, you know, great momentum with the field coming. Everything's changing for sports. You know, this is a lot of momentum. Let's keep it rolling. I think this is a great opportunity for these kids. I hope my son start playing this year in first grade. It all comes down to good coaching, which we already have. I've seen, you know, all safety comes down to good coaching, proper tackling, and everything else, which I've used my whole life. Even though I got a couple concussions, that was mainly because I didn't follow proper tackling. But here I am. I can stand up straight. I can add. I can subtract. I can divide. I can function properly. So here I am, I'm your specimen. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Ryan LeBlanc. I'm actually pretty new to this town. I'm a student athlete. I actually coached most of these kids back here. I come from Kittery. I don't know if you guys are familiar with that town. We did have a football team there. Yes, we only had 350 kids in the whole school. But I played football from when I was in second grade all the way till I was a senior. We didn't have the greatest of teams. We lost every single game for five seasons straight, but we still went out there every single day to practice. It was just such a passionate thing. Football is a very passionate sport. And I believe that it's really going to help these kids if they can cooperate with Portsmouth and play with them. So I hope you guys will sway your vote and say yes to this tonight. That's all I have to say. But please say yes.
Thank you. Okay, I'm going to close the public comment. We can move to the approval of minutes. Could I have a motion to approve the March 2nd, 2016 regular minutes? Denise?
I'll motion to approve the March 2nd, 2016 regular minutes.
Moved by Denise. Is there a second? Seconded by Al. Are there corrections? Hearing none, ready to vote. All those in favor of approving those minutes, please raise your hand. Six in favor. Student rep abstains, I assume, since you weren't here. The minutes are approved. We have a motion to approve the March 3rd, 2016 start time meeting minutes. Denise?
A motion to approve the March 3rd, 2016 start time meeting minutes.
Moved by Denise, seconded by Dan. Are there changes in that?
Hearing none, all those in favor, please raise your hand. Six in favor, the student rep abstains. Those minutes are passed. Announcements and commendations from the district.
Way down. Catherine Flora, Director of Student Services for Oyster River. I just wanted to congratulate, we have four advisors from one of our club activities at the middle school. Jean Wands, Jan O'Brien, Alex Groh, and Sue Jackson. And they started a couple of years ago an organization called Best Buddies for our students with intellectual and developmental disabilities. And they've been recognized by the chapter as our chapter being recognized for this month. So what they've done is created activities for students with disabilities to be interacting and creating one-to-one friendships, volunteer opportunities, and job and grade, integrated employment in the community. And it's been going really well, so I just wanted to congratulate them. Also, I just wanted to congratulate the high school. We had an Indicator 13 audit from the New Hampshire Department of Education, and we did very well. We don't have our findings report yet, but they assured us that we did very well. This is an audit that focuses on transition for students, so students who are 14 and over, and making sure our practices and are in compliance as well as our IEPs. So all of that staff went through technical advisory all year and worked really diligently with the New Hampshire Department of Education. They did excellent. So I just want to congratulate the high school staff as well.
Thank you, Catherine.
Dennis Harrington, Principal Moharamed. I just wanted to take a minute to do my annual praise for the daily toil in the classroom that I think is more important than what I'm about to share with you, but I think this is equally as important. We have an enrichment committee that is chaired by Holly Burr, who is a parent, and we have, tomorrow we'll be going to the Krista McAuliffe Center in Concord, the whole school, and we have spent considerable time preparing for it. And I don't think I'm a cheap radical, but
are you talking
I
about
am
me?
Cheap.
We all turn towards you.
This is what the staff developed that each child will carry with them tomorrow. And at the same time, we're practicing all-day kindergarten, because the afternoon kindergartners will be coming with us on the field trip. And I can't say enough about the enrichment committee and the work that it has put, the detail and the work that has been put into preparing for this field trip is commendable. And I'd like to also recognize John Giafforte, I guess I got his name wrong here. He is the director of the observatory at UNH. He has been our consultant. He actually came in and did some professional development at one of our staff meetings in preparation for this visit, and has arranged for families next week after our visit to go as a family to a starry night at UNH Observatory, where families will be able to go into the observatory. There'll be telescopes set up outside with volunteers, and it will be a starry night, I hope. So if it, I wasn't cheap enough not to make copies of this, and if any of you would like to attend, you're welcome to come. Thank you.
I'm moving.
Mike McCann, High School. Just a couple of things from the high school. This weekend is the One Act Play Festival here at the high school, which there are eight shows, but there's a lot of director and student forum, actor forums that go on during the day, which starts at 6 a.m. and it goes on till about 10 o'clock at night. So it's a long day, but the kids have a lot of fun. It is open to the public to come in and see what's happening. Also, I just want to say that our high school, you know, the high school is really excited about the field project. But I want to commend our students on their, on taking the initiative to get out there and encourage people to vote for the field project, especially our seniors who really aren't going to be able to benefit from the field and the track as a high school athlete, but I just think it says a lot about who our students are. Also, this month's Apple Award winner is Kara Sullivan, who is recognized for her hard work and dedication in creating excellent learning environments in her classrooms. And finally, the moment everyone's been waiting for, I'd like to propose Friday, June 10th as the graduation date for the class of 2016. So fortunately, we've been blessed with good weather and one cancellation, so we really are in good shape, and that should, hopefully it'll stay.
Have you heard about Monday?
No.
So okay, thank you.
That will work.
All right. And the weather will be good, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Thank you.
Thanks.
My pen.
I just had to, I'm Todd Allen, Assistant Superintendent. I just had to get up and just to say something about the Athletic Fields Project, just because, there's so many people I'd love to thank at this point, starting with the board for embracing this project and bringing it forward. But if I started listing names of all the people in the last 19 years of this project effort that have contributed to it, I would miss somebody. I will tell you there are hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people who have donated money that is in the trust fund. There's the various members of the Friends of Oyster River Track. There's the various community members that organized the Go Vote effort. I will mention a couple of names only because I think they really went above and beyond. Rob Sullivan, amazing. That guy, I tell you, if you want to get something done, ask Rob to get involved. He did an amazing job. Kathy O'Brien's involvement in it was just spectacular. Evan Gordon and all the students that were involved in it, just an amazing, amazing effort. And, you know, it's just, it's having been involved in it for as long as I have, it's still kind of surreal to me that it actually is going to happen. It's one of these things that I've always thought, like, yeah, I'll be retired before it happens, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
But now it's we're actually talking about this fall. So thank you to everybody in the community who voted for it. It's going to be a thing of great pride in the community, and I think it's just fantastic. Is the Assistant Superintendent's report on the agenda?
It isn't, so go right ahead into your next
one. Do you want me to just go right into it?
Could I just say you left out one name of somebody who was really key to the whole thing.
Corey Park.
And that's Todd Allen.
Yes. And John Parsons. I'd like to throw his name out there, too. He's been an active supporter. I do have one item that I would have included under the Assistant Superintendent report I just wanted to make you aware of. As you know, we had a tragedy in the community just before February vacation. We lost a 10-year-old under very tragic circumstances. Clearly, there are a lot of issues associated with that we as a community need to wrestle with. Heather Mackinoff and myself and the rest of the leadership team in the district have been working with DBART, which is an organization. DBART, it's D-B-H-R-T. It stands for Disaster Behavioral Response Team. And they basically specialize in helping communities deal with sudden traumatic issues of this sort. We are working with them to plan an April 5th community forum that will involve mental health experts from DBART, Chief Kirsch from the Durham Police Department, as well as many school officials. Our intent is, we're not necessarily going to be able to answer all the questions people have, but our intent is to begin that dialogue in hopes of kind of finding a way forward that will be in a positive light for the district. So I included a memo in your board backup, but it gives you the information. And as I have more information, obviously it will be publicized. Yes.
Do you know where it's going to be yet?
It's going to be here at the high school, either the library or here in the auditorium. But it's probably going to be in a more intimate setting, just because we expect it to be, hopefully, more of a dialogue, a conversation. Okay. All right. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Todd. Announcements and commendations from the board. Al.
I had two quick ones. First, when you're talking about the fields passing, when I stood out for 10 hours in front of the high school on poll day, I thought the greatest story was from John Parsons, who said that his mom was one of the first people to give money for the track. And she kept asking him over and over again, when are we going to get the track, John? So it's really nice to know that we can finally say it's coming. And the second one, there was a performance here last week of Macbeth that was put on for the students. And I think it's part of a larger effort with Martin Brewer, remembering him. And it was absolutely amazing. And so the actors put on the performance, and then they had a workshop with the students afterwards, and it was just amazing.
Other announcements and accommodations? Sarah?
I just want to commend all of the Oyster River students who stood up here tonight. It's incredibly hard to stand at this podium, and especially when you feel as passionately as you all do. So thank you.
Maria?
Just a concern. I read in the paper today that the governor's budget that she had dedicated to drug prevention and treatment was cut in half, which leaves it to us in the communities to try to address this horrible epidemic that's going on. And I know we had a presentation on our mental health programs and what's in our curriculum. But what I'm lacking is the spectacular kind of events, like having a speaker, or there's somebody here from Kittery. I know in Kittery we did the big things. I don't know that there is research that they made huge difference. I hope they did. We had the mock car accident with the whole funeral and the whole thing, which was very emotional for most students that attended. And we don't seem to do any of that stuff. Drug prevention in this community ever since I've been here has been an under the surface kind of thing. I know that the Chief Justice of the New Hampshire Superior Court has started the drug courts. That would be an interesting subject for, I think, many high school students to learn about what real people go through when these things happen. I just read a book. I recommended it to the superintendent, and it's fascinating. And I recommend it to everybody, Chasing the Scream, which is a history and really detailed look at the history of our drug war that obviously has not been that successful. Do you recommend it?
No, I absolutely recommend it. It's definitely a book that stretches your mind in places where you don't typically go. So that the author was very engaging and really pushes the envelope.
Mm-hmm. So that's my issue.
Just a thought. I'm wondering whether in the budget, it wouldn't be a big item, but to put something in to bring in speakers to create events, and then I think that would give some momentum to do that. So, you know.
Good idea.
So maybe just as we develop the budget, whether we might think something like that.
Yeah.
Denise?
Just a reminder that there's a community dinner next Thursday, March 24th. I believe it's from 5 to 6:30. So it's always a great opportunity. They have wonderful food and do a really nice job.
Great, thank you. I'd just like to thank a group that I don't think we ever really thank, and that is the people in this community who don't have kids in the school, who come out to vote for the school bond levies, to vote for the budgets. You know, I think that's a characteristic of this community that's great. It's not the sense, well, I'm not benefiting directly, therefore I'm not going to vote. It's like, this is what we're about. And I think that makes a huge, huge difference in what we can do. So thanks to them. Are there others? Are we okay? Superintendent's report.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Several things. You know, we share with the board every time or every year the number of accounts that we have, and occasionally create a new one. And just want to put on notice that Service Palooza, the activity that we do at the middle school, we've created a account at the bank for that, so that Jay and his staff can collect funds for that particular endeavor. In terms of the track, and I would tell you that 68% of the people who voted in this past election supported our fields project, including the track. We've had our first organizational meeting with our contractor, and he's in the process of putting a timeline together, which we will be able to share with the school board and the community at the next meeting. The winter being what it has been, we actually anticipate we'll be able to begin the project far earlier than we anticipated when we were talking to the community and talking this project up. So we actually may see contractors on the property before our next board meeting. That's a possibility. At the very least, you'll have a definitive timeline that I'll share with you at the next meeting. So this winter has been awesome in a lot of ways. If you're a skier, not so much. If you're a snowmobiler, not so much. But if you're trying to build and redo a fields project, perfect winter for it. The ground is not frozen. So pretty excited by that. I also wanted to let the board know the process on the principal search. We had a committee of about five that went through all the applications. We have chosen the interview committee. The committee for parents was chosen by lottery. That was purposeful so that we didn't get into personalities. You know, the superintendent favors so-and-so, so we chose Mrs. Smith or Mr. Jones. Obviously, I mean, that resulted in some people who are interested being disappointed. I did take it upon myself as superintendent to invite Dean directly. That was a suggestion at the last meeting, and I think for all the time that Dean puts in voluntarily to be here and keep us honest and straight, that he earned that privilege, so he is representing the middle school. The teaching staff chose their representatives, so that was independent of my office. And we did get Caroline as her last duty for the board to act as an interviewer for the new principal. So the interviews will happen on March 22nd. We'll spend about 8 hours together at the library going through and interviewing the six candidates. We hope to bring that down to two candidates. We have enough time between the interview and the meeting in April so that we can do visits to the schools. I plan on having staff go down and do that. And while they're visiting schools, we'll do reference checking so that we should be in a position to have a nominee for our April meeting. Always with a caveat that if we're not satisfied at the end of the interviews, we can always repost. We're still early enough in the process so that we would get good candidates. I would tell you that just in my review of the candidates, we have several that I think are top draw, and hopefully through the interview process, they'll rise to the top. So that's the process related to the principal search, and that takes care of this, my report. And Sarah has a question.
Sarah?
I have two questions. One, with the potential for the field project starting, what does that mean for graduation?
That is exactly the question that we are engaged in right now, Sarah. So I've asked Michael to meet with the seniors. There's a real possibility as we enter deeper into the conversation with the contractor that it's possible that an outside graduation wouldn't make sense this year. So Todd contacted the university to make sure we had a placeholder in terms of graduating there. But that's not definitive yet. So tonight I asked Michael if he'd take the time to talk with the seniors, let them know what's going on. It could be an issue of safety with the equipment. Could be, you know, if we had a wet spring and you're doing construction, you end up with a big mud hole. Could be it's super dry and you end up with a dust bowl. So there's lots of reasons for us to investigate a serious option other than our usual outdoor tent. We're still in that conversation with the contractor. We do have a backup plan, and I asked the high school principal to sit with the kids and make sure that they know so they don't get caught short. But this is a real possibility.
Okay. Thank you.
Did you have, you say it another one? Or?
I did. My other one was, and I don't know if you can answer this one about the candidates for principal, but I guess the question is, my assumption is that all these candidates are going to have principal certification at the time of their hiring, and if they don't, they are in the process of getting that.
Yeah, I can share that. So five of the six have it in their hand, and the sixth one is in the process of getting it. So everybody will be certified.
Thank you.
Denise?
Just regarding the graduation, I made a joke about Monday, but I did truly hear that we may have a big storm on Monday, snowstorm. Is it an issue if there is one more?
No, we wait this long to announce graduation, and we have agreed as a school board and as an administration that once the announcement is made, we stay true to that. Right. You know, you might recall several years ago, we inadvertently led the community to believe it was one date, and that wasn't the intention, and it turned out to be a firestorm because so many people make plans in advance. Many families come from not just out of state, but from other countries. So we learned from that experience that now that Michael has said it's going to be June 10th, it will be June 10th if we have five snow days, because we just really have to, this is the commitment we're making to the seniors and their families.
Other questions for Jim? Okay. Okay, it's time to begin the discussion item on the football cooperative with Portsmouth. So, Corey, I think some number of the questions will be...
Do you want the election results?
Oh, you want to do that? Sure.
Yeah. So let me just pull it up really quickly.
Okay.
Thank you for your patience. Obviously we're already talking about the track. The track needed, because it was a bond, needed 60%. It actually got 68%. And many, many people had said thank you tonight to the community. I just want to add my thank you to all the hard work of community members who made this happen. You know, it was an overnight success. It only took 19 years. So we're very pleased with that result. But equally pleased with the other articles that were passed. Our RESPA contract passed handily, about 4-1. The Orchard Drive property passed about 5-1. The capital reserve account passed 4-1. The last warrant article the board approved, which was just to set aside a couple thousand dollars on the ability to give our poorest youngsters a leg up in technology, passed by almost 80%. So I'm really, really pleased with the community support for that. And the overall operating budget, pretty amazing, 69%. So as Tom alluded to in thanking the community, you have to recognize that a budget is a major endeavor where only one in five families in the district have children. And so if only families voted, we would never get a budget passed. And if you were here during election day, you see many seniors working for the towns, and you see many seniors voting throughout the day. So this isn't just a tribute to the parents in this room or in the community. It's really a tribute to a multi-generational commitment to public education in Oyster River, and I sincerely thank everyone.
Thank you. Okay, now we'll move to the discussion of the Football Cooperative of Portsmouth. So I have a couple questions to get us started. The first one is, at the meeting, at two meetings ago, we asked that there be a definitive final version of the agreement. Do we have that?
We do not have the definitive final. However, I do have another draft that I was working on with the athletic director at Portsmouth today to put in the language regarding the liability. We have confirmation from their insurance company that they would be fully covered through the Portsmouth SAU policy once our student athletes would agree to be a part of their team. So any involvement whatsoever with their program would fall into that category. The only reason I say we do not have it final is because I have not confirmed from their lawyers that the language that I suggested to Russ Wilson was affirmative. Their lawyer, from what I was told, was out of the country, or one of their lawyers that handles this case. And so they have the proposal draft that I can happily pass around to you all if you'd like to see it. And then page 2 and 3, you can kind of see the highlighted portion that simply covers number 7 on the administrative of the program, is that Oyster River student athletes would be covered fully by the Portsmouth SAU insurance policy.
But this has not been reviewed by their lawyer?
I'm sorry?
Has this been reviewed by their lawyer?
This is not, because they're out of town. So we started the ball with the conversation of drafting the language, and we're waiting to hear back that the way we, myself and their administration, put it in writing would be appropriate.
Okay. Okay. Go ahead.
So the version that we received, the question that I had was that it says schools shall share equally in the sport participation fee. And my understanding is that the athletes will be paying. So I'm just trying to, you know, and maybe it's different in that, but in this version here, I just wanted to clarify that.
Yeah, thank you for mentioning, because that's another item that is highlighted on the new proposal, that it states specifically that the funding will not come from the Oyster River School District, and that it would come from the participant's family. I believe that is on page 3 in the top.
Let me push this down. I don't know if you can answer this question off the top of your head, but when you read through a cooperative agreement, one of the things it says, it's an option for a school that is in danger of losing its program, which is actually the justification we used for approving the hockey cooperative, that our district really had low numbers, and therefore it was essential to form a cooperative so you got enough players. So I guess with that, my question is, how many players are on the Portsmouth football team, and what is an adequate number of football players to have a standalone program?
I know it's a tough one. They average about 50 student athletes to participate in their program, and one of the concerns that they currently have is with the divisional football alignment of last year when it came out, they are placed in the Division I. And so because of that, they are in a division where they are enrollment-wise the second smallest school. But in football, they actually do have some of these smaller numbers across the board. And so a lot of the participation would not only be, and that's not to say our student athletes would be part of the junior varsity program, but the enticement from Portsmouth would be able to round out their entire roster with the addition of Oyster River student athletes so that they could have a full junior varsity program to mimic the varsity program. So to your point, where it's different from the hockey environment is, I think that cooperative agreement was one to be able to sustain our varsity hockey program. Without a cooperative agreement with Portsmouth, I'm fairly certain their program would still survive to offer varsity football. But certainly putting ninth graders in a scenario of playing in a varsity game is part of their concern. And on the same kind, having a full roster for those ninth graders to compete at the junior varsity level is certainly something they're interested in doing. You know, comparing roster sizes, they're going up against Bedford, Pinkerton, Concord, Exeter, you know, 80 to 85 kids that are dressing within their program. And so being around 50, it is a small number.
I have a follow-up to that. In the agreement, the draft agreement that we saw, Portsmouth would want to exit the agreement if there's they go to 4 divisions and they would be able to drop down to Division 2. Is that correct?
That is correct with the 4 division model or any scenario where they would drop a division. Okay. Currently, football, there's three divisions across the state. And so the way that 2 years ago they had six divisions of football, mm-hmm. and they decided at that time that that was too many division offerings because mm-hmm. there wasn't enough teams in each division. Mm-hmm. So they opted to go to a three-division model. With the division model and 58 schools participating in football, Portsmouth became the smallest Division I school, where they've traditionally been a Division II size school, where they are in every
basketball,
sport,
yeah.
basketball, mm-hmm. soccer, so on and so forth. And so their interest is to remain an individual school. If at any point the reconfiguration of numbers from the NHIA turns and they would become a Division II or lower school. I without having that exact wording, but essentially where they would not be competing against the larger schools in the state. So if their numbers were to drop, because they put that in the general information, that at that point they would not seek continuing the cooperative agreement. So at the conclusion of that year, they would want to release themselves from the cooperative agreement.
At what point will the decision be made whether to go to four divisions? Do you have a sense of that?
So next fall is when they start. Every 2 years, they look at the entire schedule for all sports. And so at the conclusion of next fall is a year out from the second year of the new cycle. They would start that discussion most likely at the football committee meeting that meets in August, and then again throughout the late fall to determine twofold. One, the reclassification of the following year if the numbers were to shift across the board within three divisions. But they also would be discussing, are they satisfied with a three-division alignment for the state of New Hampshire, or would they want to go to a four-division or two-division? You know, that conversation would come up every 2 years. And speaking with the NHIA today, they cannot confirm either way what that discussion will look like next fall. I know this past year, when they went from six divisions to three divisions, there was a lot of people that loved it across the state, and there was a lot of people that didn't like it across the state because they were happy with the six divisions. So it's really hard to gauge right now the trend across the state as to what people want, because New Hampshire is really unique when you look at 58 schools participating in football, Pickerton with 3,100 students, and Massacoma with 340. That's a wide disparity. So in some people's arguments that even three divisions isn't enough for that disparity.
Okay.
And so where it's, I think it's only safe to assume in any divisional alignment above three divisions that Portsmouth would be in a lower division because they are the smallest school in Division I that's not petitioning in to be Division I. So any kind of configuration, I do not see them where they would fall, or excuse me, stay above that threshold with the four division, with the four division alignment.
And just one follow-up then. So if in this next decision round they would go to four or more divisions, that would mean this agreement would terminate after the first, really almost in December, after that football season. That first football season. So essentially what you'd get is one season. Is that right?
Yes.
If that's
possibility would be there because yeah. this agreement would take place in 2017, not 2016, given okay. the timeline required for okay. the cooperative agreement. So the reality of having playing that football season of 2017, there is the chance that at the conclusion of that season, we would already know if they were going to a four-division model. That we would no longer have the opportunity to continue the cooperative agreement with Portsmouth at that time.
Maria, go ahead.
Since I haven't got a clue what you're talking about when you're talking about divisions and stuff like that, I have looked at what I have available about how to make decisions. I looked at our comprehensive plan, or where it says that our goal is safety of our kids, and I'm glad that we have a gentleman here who feels he's doing okay. I'd like to check on you in 20 years when early dementia sets in. So safety of the kids is high on my list. And looking at the research, I cannot find any place where it says that football is a safety thing. The other thing I looked at was the school board members' ethics policy, BCA. Make decisions only after full discussion at public board meetings. We've done that. Render all decisions based on available facts in my independent judgment and the facts from medical research and what is being presented both in newspapers and on television is that football is a huge concern. And the last part of that sentence says, and refuse to surrender that judgment to individuals or special interest groups. To me, this is a special interest group. The other thing I looked at was one of the pages in the NHIAA stuff, where it says, the hope is that ultimately each school will develop enough interest to sustain the sport independently. And I cannot believe that if we went into this for one semester, that the kids after one semester or one season would say, oh, that was great, thank you, and leave it at that. So to get away from the don't surrender to special interest groups, I would love to make a motion that we put this issue on the next ballot, on the warrant article, to see if the community, not just the small, want to start this, because if we start it, it's going to move forward to wanting Oyster River to have a football team, which both cost money, cost field space, and this is a safety issue in my opinion. So I make the motion that we put it on the next ballot.
You have to say put what on the next ballot?
Whether or not the community wants to start football. In whatever form that might be it cooperative, be it the knowledge, or at least my interpretation that it will continue into what NHIAA says, that they hope that we developed an independent team. Okay. That's what it says here.
Okay, so a motion, you're going to make a motion that the issue of forming a football team at Oyster River will be put on the ballot.
Is that yes.
In March 2017, right?
Yes, that's the next one.
Okay. Is there a second to that motion? Hearing none, the motion fails. Okay. So we continue the discussion.
Question for Corey, and I apologize because I think you may have addressed this before, but are there any other high schools that Oyster River could form a cooperative with? Just out of curiosity, if Portsmouth said, okay, you know, we're all set, thank you very much.
Sure. We've explored that with all the seacoast options, and as recent as 2 weeks ago, with a couple of discussion points, there is no schools that have expressed interest in wanting to do this. The divisional alignment, I think, is that really tricky part with that, because when you add the enrollment, you do move up a division for pretty much all the lower level schools, and one local school that does not have football expressed that they are not interested in trying to do football at this time, which would be the logical cooperative creation of a football program.
Dan, go ahead.
Just a quick follow-up to that one. So if we were to move forward with the
cooperative...
If we were to move forward with the cooperative with Portsmouth and the divisional realignment occurred, Portsmouth went to Division II, our cooperative essentially would be ended. How do you envision we would respond, knowing that there don't seem to be plan Bs out there in terms of other schools to work with, or, you know, my concern would be we have these kids who are so invested in this program, who are fighting so hard for it, and I'm very receptive to that, but I'd hate to see them, you know, sort of have a brief glimpse of what they want and then have their hopes dashed in the very near term.
Sure. Yeah, that's a great question. And I think that's part of the bigger discussion with not just the cooperative agreement. I think the idea of football and full transparency is key and full communication. I know the two meetings ago, there was a few parents that spoke up in public comment saying, even if it's 2 years and you're telling us it's 2 years and we know that, it's 2 years worth. And so I wish I could say I knew the next 10 years as far as our divisional alignments, because it is a really moving, it's a moving part to this scenario. But I do think long term, the intent would be to provide our own program here at the school. And if the cooperative agreement becomes healthy and 15 kids want to come out for it, and the youth program thrives through seeing that high school piece, similar conversation 2 weeks ago with ice hockey, you know, the hope would be that those numbers would continue to flourish at fifth grade, sixth grade, seventh grade, so that at some point it would turn into Oyster River only football program, regardless of if the cooperative dissolved. I think in the short term, because it literally could be 1 year of participating in football, because I don't see any of the bylaws or the timing of scheduling classification from the NHI changing, I think that's a really fair question to ask and to explain to the families of this potentially could be a one-year cooperative agreement. And the scenario I'm thinking is if eight kids wanted to play. The likelihood of trying to create our own program with eight kids is not possible. Even if those eight kids are really dedicated, the numbers is where you need to be in football. So you need at least 30-plus kids to be able to sustain your own team. That is, in my opinion, the worst-case scenario. The other side of this coin could be if only 10 kids ever wanted to play, and the division alignment didn't change across the state, and Portsmouth remained in Division One, and there was only a three-division cycle, the cooperative agreement could flourish, and it could be a great outlet for those individuals in the time that the cooperative agreement stays in path if our numbers didn't grow. But certainly, I think as a school board and for the NHIA to approve this, because keep in mind, we would every 2 years need to go back to them if nothing changed with Portsmouth's Division One status. Once our numbers grew to a point of 30 or more, I think similar to the conversation we'll have with them with hockey, they wouldn't necessarily approve a co-op at that point. The intention would be fabulous. The co-op has done its served its purpose, and now you can offer your own Oyster River football team. So I do think, although it is the future, I think that is something to take into some consideration when looking at the cooperative agreement.
Could I just follow up on that? So yeah. I assume that you would go before the NHIAA board to talk about this agreement, is that?
Yes.
Okay. And if they asked you, has the Oyster River School Board endorsed moving forward to having a football team, and you said it hasn't at this point, would that make this agreement hard to even get by the NHIA?
It would need to be school board approved as yeah. part of the application process.
Well, so I guess what I'm saying is, if you're saying the intent of the cooperative is to build a football team, but if the board's position hasn't taken a position to build a football team, can you make that assurance?
I'm sorry. It endorses its own football team.
Yeah.
Correct.
Yeah.
Can I make the assurance that the NHIA would be...
Well, how would they... I mean, maybe I'm asking how they would react to that. Is that something that's expected as part of this application?
I would think so. I mean, certainly that meeting at the NHIA level would be with the building principal and most likely Dr. Morris. to speak on behalf of the school board's commitment to fulfilling this opportunity for kids, not just in the immediate short term for those individuals partaking in the cooperative agreement, but long term for the viability and sustainability of that program.
Okay.
I can see that question being asked, yes.
Okay. Sarah, I'm sorry, go ahead.
It's okay. So when is the, you know, we had talked earlier that when we saw this a month ago.
I can't hear.
Oh, sorry. I hear so well at these, I forget. So we had, when we saw this a month ago, we were told, you know, even if we voted that night, these kids wouldn't be playing in the fall.
Correct.
Because of the okay, so when is the next deadline for the next possible time that they would play? You know, is it far enough away that we could put this on the March 2017, you know, or is that too late?
That's too late.
Okay.
The football, and speaking with the executive director of the NHA today, the football committee would address this cooperative proposal at their August meeting. And so at their August sport committee meeting, where is the first line of the community, where it starts the approval process or the application process, they would meet in August, and then based on the football committee's stance, it would go to the cooperative committee, most likely the following month.
Okay.
But certainly waiting to next voting cycle would slow this down another year. I don't foresee slowing this down more than 1 year,
right,
because we're pretty much at that same exact point now. So if we're looking at 2017, March 16th, and there was a 4 vote for it, let's just say last
right.
Tuesday, and then we proceeded with this application to the NHIA, it would still be addressed next August at their football committee meeting.
At the 2017 meeting?
Correct.
Okay, so a year later.
Correct.
Okay. And then I guess my other question has to do with money. So currently Portsmouth has a program. Mm-hmm. I have very vague memories of football in high school, but I seem to remember it involving a lot of training equipment, places to put that training equipment, weight room, a trainer. And I guess with Portsmouth being the home program right now, they have all that stuff.
Correct.
And I guess my question is, and I have a call into ORYA, but I haven't heard back, how much, if we were to have to do a program, mm-hmm. how much does all of that cost? And, I mean, I know we sort of came up with this with the music program. When we expanded the music program, we had to expand the number of instruments we purchased, and I know the middle school, at least, is really struggling with where do we store those instruments. So I would ask the same thing. Where do we store that big, you know, that, I mean, it seemed like a pretty sure. substantial amount of equipment.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess I'm trying to look at what is this all going to cost? Once, like right now in the short term, great. Our kids could play at Portsmouth. It would be no cost other than cost to the families. I get that. But clearly the intent is that this is going to be a program that some want to continue. If that were the case, how much would that cost us? And you know, in materials, in possible places to store it, in personnel, because you can't just necessarily, I wouldn't think, get a volunteer as a trainer. So expense is a big concern, and I guess I'm looking for sort of a number on that. And also with the Title IX issues, the potential of then having to offer more female sports or at least options, you know, there's money going that place too. And I go back to that same rabbit hole that I was in 2 meetings ago of we're a public school system. As much as I want to offer everything, we can't. And so I guess my question after all of that, how much money is this going to cost?
So hard to give you an exact number, but certainly just to kind of revisit where you're, it's certainly turnkey in the short term. With,
right.
with the cooperative Absolutely. Agreement, aside from the total expense of a program at Portsmouth divided by total number of student athletes, and then that number would be per kid.
Right.
Here at the high school, when we visited this conversation roughly 3 years ago, and we put a committee together, facilities was one of the largest hurdles. Right. I'm excited to announce, obviously, with the turf field and currently fundraising efforts and putting lights and fulfilling that facility, I think the facility piece becomes much more manageable, because with the turf field and hopefully the fundraising we're going to do for lights, we've now extended our day 2.5 hours in the fall. So to add a program on campus, that possibility is there. Some trickier ones are certainly the equipment and the cost, because if we were to dissolve the cooperative agreement and become our own program, the Portsmouth helmets and pads and everything that we'd be using in the cooperative would go away. And so roughly, you're probably looking at about a $40,000 expense to outfit the program.
And that's like training equipment, trainer.
That doesn't take into consideration the trainer, but if we're able to get on site here, our athletic trainer who's here every day after school, okay, contracted through Rev 3, I think that resolves itself because they would be on prep site. The bigger concern a couple years ago was if the team would be at Woodridge or another facility in town, because needing the trainer present at a football practice is much more prominent than... Nothing against field hockey or soccer,
right,
but just with the immediate contact on every play, that's something that they would need to be floating by that field pretty much the entire day. The facility questions that I cannot answer with a number are some of the external things that, not to say we couldn't survive, but an upgrade of our current weight room scenario, a certain upgrade of our current locker room environment, and an upgrade or more creative approach to our storage would something that would definitely need to be considered. And certainly those type of things are already somewhat being discussed with the new facility, with the concrete slab that's going under the bleachers we're fundraising for, in hopes of utilizing that area to be storage covered, obviously. And certainly that area is one that we're hoping can create more storage for us through fundraising efforts. So I think the locker room is the biggest concern. Right now, that's a very difficult environment after school, any season that we have, and we're not including any students. I know Troy's nodding his head because he experiences it two of the three seasons. And so that would be a very pressing matter. Small in the scope of providing an opportunity to kids, but certainly something to consider as far as the long-term sustainability of providing the program that we would want to provide, much like every other program we have. So I can get some ballparks for some storage and talk to Jim Rizicki, but I do think that is a challenging part of this, is being able to sustain this on site. And so that process of planning for that would start immediately if a cooperative agreement was assigned, with the long-term plan of better be safe to be able to provide here on site. So that would be a large mission of mine.
Could I just have a follow-up to that? I'd just like to get back, because you alluded to the Title IX issue, which I think is a really important one to kind of sort out. And we have a letter from Melissa Huey, I hope I'm pronouncing her name right. So we've got a legal opinion just in terms of where we stand with Title IX and what would happen if there was a big addition of football players who would either play here or play, you know, in the co-op. And so I'll just read from her letter. We do not know how many boys will elect to participate in the football program, but it's almost certain that the addition of the football opportunity for boys will throw these numbers out of alignment. I mean, she alluded to our numbers are almost exactly in alignment right now. However, regardless of the number of boys opting to participate in football, providing a football opportunity to boys will only result in putting the district out of Title IX compliance if there are interests and abilities of female students that are not being met. So my understanding is that if we, you know, probably if we're talking about 6 or 8, that's not going to make a huge difference. But if we're talking like 15, 20, we're beginning to put ourselves out of alignment, and we'd have to find some way of putting ourselves back in alignment. And one way, according to this letter, is that we could survey the female students to see if there's a sport that they would like to participate in. And I would be, you know, I mean, perhaps like rowing, you know, I would think that would be a possibility to have a female-only rowing team, then that we would, and my understanding is that we would have to go forward with offering that sport to put ourselves in alignment. We couldn't just say, okay, we've surveyed the interest, you have an interest. We would have to either do that, or what's happened at the university is to eliminate a male sport to put ourselves back in alignment. The university has eliminated swimming, you know, varsity swimming. So if the numbers grow, that we put ourselves out of compliance with Title IX, and we would have to do something to put ourselves back in compliance. Am I reading that? Is that?
Yeah, the only piece of that that I'd like to just include is if the numbers grow that are not current athletes.
Okay.
So if 15 boys from boys soccer decided to be that 15 that wanted to go play football, it would shift your numbers. So if it's student athletes that are not currently being a student athlete here at Oyster River, that's where the numbers could really get skewed.
Is it doing it participating or participating in a fall sport?
No, it's across the board. It's not just fall sport. So it's all sports taken into consideration. So in the fall, we're already somewhat lopsided with a larger number of boys participating than girls, mainly because our interest right now in boys soccer is higher than I think it's ever been. Uh-huh. So that certainly could go in waves, but it's not just seasonal. So it would be, so the opportunity to provide another opportunity to women in crew season, which I believe is in the spring, or it could be in the spring.
Could be either one, I think. Yeah.
That wouldn't necessarily hurt our numbers, as long as the participation opportunities were present and the kids took advantage of them.
Okay.
And they wanted to take advantage of them. So that survey could result in some more feedback if that was something you guys would want me to send out to our female student body.
I was just raising it and just trying to see what, because we have been sued in the history of this board, at least for some of us, for Title IX compliance. We've already been out of compliant and had to make changes. So that's not just a hypothetical problem. Mm-hmm. Denise, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Yeah. So I guess where I am at right now is, first of all, I really do appreciate, everybody who spoke tonight and people who are kind of sitting through all the discussion and really, think seriously about, wanting to provide opportunities for students. I'm certainly not thinking I would be comfortable voting tonight because, first of all, I want to see the final version of this contract, which, sounds like they have to wait until the lawyer looks at it and that sort of thing. I also feel that we have a board member missing tonight who I feel has maybe some, strong interest or whatever in it. And so I know for myself, I would, like to have more time to certainly kind of mull this over. I feel like, and I know that's frustrating for folks who are hoping for an answer tonight, but I feel like it is complicated. I know for myself, I really thought that, let's go ahead and just approve, this cooperative and we're not on the hook for anything more. But now I'm really hearing something different from you. And so for me, that really kind of shifts the discussion, and I really feel like I need to think about that a lot more because of all these different, the costs associated, Title IX, all those different kinds of things. So I know that's where I'm at right now.
Cool. Al?
So, I think for me personally, of 4 years being on the board, this is probably one of the most difficult decisions coming before me. I've really, really, really struggled with this. And I agree with Denise. On the surface, when I first heard about this, I want as many kids to participate in athletics as possible. And so if there's an opportunity for kids to participate in athletics, I support it. I think it's a great thing. The medicals is beyond troubling to me. It is frightening when I look at the science behind this. And it's very, very difficult for me to get over that. But that said, what I'm having real trouble, the sticking point is exactly what Denise is saying, and that is, and I thought Maria's idea of a vote is a great vote. I just don't know about March of next year being the place. But I think it's one thing to say that I'm going to give you guys opportunities to go play at Portsmouth, and it's another thing that I'm saying we are approving football at Oyster River night. I know that may sound unfair, but I've heard a tremendous amount of people saying they really don't want it. And I don't have an adequate way to gauge right now what that is, what the sense the community wants. So I don't know how we solve that.
Isn't that what this forum's for?
Excuse me. This is not, it's a board discussion right now.
Who said that?
So we've had, the, if people, if there are further questions for Corey, are there further questions?
No.
Sarah?
Yeah, I mean, I think I agree initially when it was really just a conversation about allowing parents to make the decision for their children to play in Portsmouth. It's a very different decision. But I also am intrigued by Maria's idea of putting it to a community vote in March of 2017. And to be honest, I want to have time to think about that. That's something that I need to, and we can bring it up at the next board meeting. And because I, and is there a way to make a vote not at that meeting? You know, can you make an earlier vote? You know, I would hate to put it off a year, but aren't there special meetings and things?
Yeah, in order to have a special election, you need a compelling reason, and a judge needs to approve it. So it's a much bigger deal than just saying, okay, Let's have a special election.
Okay. If there's further discussion, further questions.
If I could just add one thing, and I know student athletes, I commend you guys for coming out tonight and really speaking your piece. In speaking with the NHI today, the indication of the potential of this not being going to vote tonight was asked of me, and I said, if it wasn't in 2 weeks and it was, would that slow this process? And he indicated it would not. So, again, I do feel for the student athletes that have attended this evening and parent supporters. But the executive director indicated this 2 weeks, certainly with school board member Rotner not here, that wouldn't stump this growth for the approval process for next fall.
Okay. Okay, if there's no further questions or nobody wants to make a motion, we'll move on.
Okay.
Okay, the next item of business is the process for board outreach to staff. For the late start, and then in your packet, I think you have questions from Denise and myself. Did everybody get that?
Yeah, it's in the packet.
Okay.
Somewhere on the file.
The questions are almost identical. You know, I think they're very parallel. And I thought what would happen is, the leadership team would get together, kind of combine or reword, you know, combine Denise's questions and my questions, or rework those. Did you get it?
Well, are you talking about this one? Oh, it's on the back. Oh, okay.
Yeah. Found it. Sorry, yeah. I didn't realize it was on the back.
It's in the back.
So rather than wordsmith these in a meeting, mm-hmm. Remember how much fun that's been.
Yeah.
That and they're very similar questions, you know, I mean, that Denise and I have come up with, that we as a leadership team will meet and kind of come to the next meeting with a set of questions that the board would approve. And then I think maybe in the meantime, I don't know in terms of timing, because we'd need to get meetings at four different schools. And so maybe you might want to start by talking to principals, like when this might happen.
Yeah, we've been in this with the leadership team. We have had this conversation. I've had this conversation with the guild. And so we were just waiting for a green light, and we can be setting those up in April. I think the other piece of that, Tom, is maybe if board members expressed to me what school they wanted to visit, and then you could take it upon yourself to assign people.
Okay.
So if they're distributed equitably.
Okay. So we, Maria?
I was wondering, this is great, but how do we reach out to parents and survey them? Because I've heard from lots of parents they don't do it. And I know research, but we just approved full-day kindergarten, and there's more and more research saying don't start kids until they're 6 or 7, but we're still doing it. So I guess I need to know what the parents This is workable. Denise brought up preschool daycare last time for working parents, and there's lots to this. And I remember getting up after my boys got up to take them to hockey practice at 4 o'clock or something in the morning. What happens to those parents that have done that? I used to pray that the police wouldn't stop me in my pajamas and slippers driving to Snively Arena.
Do you have Jeff photographs?
It was before.
Okay. Before cameras.
It was before smartphones.
Well, we didn't get into detail in the working group, the workshop, about a step after the meeting with the schools, but I think that the sense was we would have like public forums that would, like after that, the sequence would be meet with the teachers and then to tell public forums, which I assume would be attended largely by parents. So, and then what we'd had in mind was that both in the meeting with the teachers and probably in the subsequent meetings, if parents would rather or community members would rather communicate through writing, they may feel uncomfortable speaking, that would be also invited. So I think it's that would be the next step. Sarah?
But in that meeting with in forums, I guess I'm just, and I like forums, I think they're important. I think that the conversation that happens is important, but I also think, I want to do a big show of hands, you know, as to who is in favor of changing start time and who is not, because I think we certainly have a strong sense that there's a lot of support for changing start time, but like Maria, I'm hearing from a number of community members, and they're asking, do we start a petition too? And, you know, how is it going to be documented that there are a lot of us out here too, but we're waiting for the board, you know, and the administration to tell us when it's time to chime in.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
So in the minutes from the workshop that we had, We thought the logical step was the interface with the staff, but then also to follow up immediately with a forum. I can tell you that Portsmouth did do a community survey, and you know it and the results pretty much mimic what we've been seeing, that there's interest, there's concerns. And so a forum will only draw those people who can get out that night for whatever reason and who are highly motivated. You're still not really getting a picture of the community. So, you know, after we've done the staff interface with the board, we said we would have another workshop, so that's all in the minutes, okay, to discuss what we learned from the teaching staff and then to set a course for the next step, which we have identified as a forum, and then bring that feedback back to the board and see how that influences the direction, with the idea that we would spend the summer refining from both of those activities. So there's nothing to stop the board from, say, authorizing a broader survey to the parents, and then people would have the opportunity. The only issue that I get concerned about at all is really the timing. And we really need to give parents and staff, as much of a full year's notice as possible if changes are going to happen. So there's nothing to stop us from inserting steps as we go through. But we had identified we needed to reach out to the parents, and we had identified that we were going to meet together and share our findings. And so I wouldn't get too concerned that this is the beginning and be all and end all, because each step will influence the next step. Okay. That's helpful.
Yeah, I was just going to add that, you know, when I'm thinking of forums, I keep coming back that they're structured in some way. Because if you say, are you for earlier start times or later start times, and you don't have any details, then it's really difficult to make a decision. So our process really has to be formulating a concrete plan, like this is what it would look like. Can you live with this or can you not live with it? And so that's, I think, multiple steps down the way. Getting information from the teachers in that begins to formulate or add to how we structure what those options look like. So I think we have a lot of work ahead of us, I guess is what I'm saying.
Denise?
Yeah, I really agree with Al because I know that I follow the ORCSD start time site, and what I see on there is, oh yeah, we're really in favor of this or later start time for high school, but no, we don't want elementary school starting at 7:45. So, you know, I think you're right. If you kind of throw it out there, then people are going to imagine what it's going to be. So I think it is important that we do this next step. We talk to the teachers, you know, we have some good questions, get some real specific feedback, and then come back and have another discussion here about, you know, those the next step and do we, you know, have a specific proposal that we bring forward to the community or not. But, you know, and I appreciate, again, I always appreciate all the feedback that people give, but I do, people interpret things their own way. And so I think we have to be really mindful of that.
Okay. So we're all set at least with the next step. So we'll come in with questions and, you know, be thinking about which schools you might want to go to, mm-hmm. and take that step, right? Denise?
If I can just ask a question, Dr. Morris, do you have a sense of specific times that work better for each of the schools? Because I know for myself,
sure.
Because I'm not so concerned, honestly, for myself, it doesn't matter to me if I go to the elementary, middle, or high. It's, you know, will it fit into my schedule?
Mm-hmm. So, what I have learned in trying to have conversations with the staff is that the middle school and high school work best at the end of a day,
okay.
In a structured administrative time. So Jay and Mike would dedicate one of their administrative meetings to the school board for this. And at the elementaries, it works through that coffee and conversation, that informal piece. Largely because of the length of a day at the elementary school, and so if they do theirs at the end, they're there that much later. So, but I would say that, you know, I would guarantee that Carrie and Dennis would say their staffs would be flexible. So, if we need to move everything to the end of the day, that'd be fine. You know, the staff is going to be more than open, but that's what I have worked as a superintendent, mornings with the elementary, afternoons with the middle school and high school, and it works pretty well.
What time is that coffee and conversation for the elementary, just out of curiosity?
Let's see, school starts.
Is it like before school?
It's usually 7:45.
Okay, thank you.
And it would run until about 8:45, and then they need to get ready for their classes.
Okay, thank you.
And then the high school and middle school is about 2:45. And they usually run until about 3:45.
Okay. Thank you.
Yep.
Other questions about that? Okay. We have the motion to approve the extension of the superintendent's contract. This was on the agenda last time, but by my mistake, we didn't have the language about the possible healthcare Cadillac tax, if that kicked in. That has been added to the proposed contract. So I guess I'd like a motion to approve the superintendent's contract. This is in the materials, yeah?
I motion to approve the superintendent's contract as presented tonight.
Which is an extension to
2020.
Do you want me to say specific?
Maybe, yeah,
okay,
maybe
hold on.
To say specifically.
Yeah, hold on, I need to find it. let's see. Oh, here it is. Okay, hold on 1 second, I've got it. Okay, so what we're doing is we are so we have a 2.5 increase in salary, and we are, I don't know how to say the whole thing with the health insurance, but basically have an agreement that if there is an increase due to the what they call the Cadillac tax, the excise tax, then that will result in a reopening just to discuss the insurance. I don't know if that's good enough.
Okay, that's good enough. Okay. Moved by Denise. Is there a second? Seconded by Dan. Is there discussion on this? Okay. All those in favor, please raise your hands.
I abstain.
Six in favor, the student rep abstains. Motion to approve administrator contracts as submitted by the superintendent. Yeah, could you speak? Because we had a kind of a plan to bring administrator contracts up to the top quartile. Is that correct?
Correct.
And this is part of that process.
Yeah, this is a three-year agreement between ORAA and the board to adjust administrative salaries for a couple of reasons. One is to bring them into the top quartile in the state, but also to make sure that the differential between each administrator makes sense based on the responsibilities that they have. And so this was part of the negotiating effort by the board last year for this year and the next several years.
So could I have a motion to approve the proposed administrator contracts? Al?
I'd like to make a motion to approve the administrator contracts for the assistant superintendent, the business administrator, and the director of special services.
Moved by Al. Is there a second? Seconded by Maria. Is there discussion on this? Hearing none, all those in favor, please raise your hand. Six in favor, student rep abstains. Okay. A motion to nominate and approve the continuing contract professional staff members as submitted by the superintendent. This was that long list we had. I'm sorry.
Three pages to your motion.
Okay. Do you want just to add that as another motion?
Just say move the slate.
Let me go back. I'm missing them. All right. So I'd like to make a motion to nominate and approve the continuing contract of professional staff members as a slate.
Okay. Moved by Al. So seconded by Denise.
I have a question.
Okay.
Are there people on here that have been shifted?
Okay.
I'm sorry.
That's okay. Are there changes that are staff members moving buildings?
There is going to be staff members moving. So we posted a kindergarten position at Massway and a fifth grade position at the middle school internally. So these aren't positions that we're looking for outside candidates for. These are positions where if we didn't fill them with internal candidates, someone would end up losing their job. So the answer to your question is yes, and it's the result of the shrinking enrollment at Mohermit and the fact that we had a retirement at the middle school.
Okay.
And I guess it,
I'm sorry, we talk, which group are we talking about?
Professional staff.
This is the professional staff.
Okay.
So do I have to worry if I look at this and I see a school and I'm like, I don't think that teacher's at that school, I think they're at another school?
No, it's not about location.
Okay.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Thanks, Sarah.
I just want to make sure I'm clear. Have we approved all of the administrator salaries? And you made a motion to approve it.
So I should amend the motion and say that we approve all of the ORAA salaries as a slate, because we've only approved, sadly, there are people that are nervous out there, we've only approved a couple of the ORAAs. So we need to approve the rest of them. That's what I'm thinking.
So wait a minute. I guess I'm confused now.
Okay, could you, here's what I'd like to do. Withdraw, let's see.
Didn't we already approve it, though?
So if you could withdraw the other person.
Who seconded Al's motion? So could we withdraw that?
I'll withdraw it.
Withdraw.
You have to get consensus of everybody, since everybody voted.
Got it.
Okay.
To
no pieces.
Okay.
I think the easiest thing to approve three of them, which is to make a motion to approve the rest of them, okay?
Where are the rest of them?
So if you roll down, unlike me,
on the administrative contract one?
You'll see that there's two other pages.
Oh, okay. Got it. I was going sideways.
So we've approved three. Let's approve the rest. Is that similar to the withdrawing stuff? Okay.
The motion is to approve the rest of the ORAA administrative contracts.
Okay. Why don't you...
They could be in the minutes. Yeah.
Okay. So are we all clear? We approved the first page. We're approving the other two pages now, okay? I was with you, Al, so I thought you'd do this. You know? So are we clear what we're voting on now? Okay. Discussion?
Yeah.
Second.
Did you get a second?
I'll second.
Seconded by Dan. Okay. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Six in favor, the student rep abstaining. Okay, thank you. What?
The continuing contracts.
Staff.
Okay. A motion to nominate and approve the continuing contract professional staff members is submitted by the superintendent. Denise?
I will motion to make that, to approve the continuing.
Who did? Yeah.
I did it, yeah, so we kind of backed up. So the motion
I thought that's how we were voting and we were the other ones.
Okay. So now we have the so we have that motion on the floor?
Yeah.
Okay. It's moved by Al and seconded by?
Denise.
Okay. Is there discussion on that? Are we all clear what we're voting on now? Okay. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Okay. Six in favor, the student rep abstains. I guess we need a motion to, we've all signed that MS-22 form, but if we have a motion to, I guess, put it officially, we've signed that, you know, so we have a motion to approve that. Al?
I'd like to make a motion to approve the MS-22 form.
Moved by Al. Is there a second? Maria? All those in favor, please raise your hands. Six in favor, the student rep abstains. Okay. Committee updates. We
are coaches.
Oh, Jesus. Sorry. Thank you. Motion to approve the Oyster River High School volunteer coaches and Mastway stipend nomination. Maybe a motion on that one? Denise?
I'll make a motion to approve the ORHS volunteer coaches and Mastway stipend nominations.
Moved by Denise, seconded by Al. Discussion? All those in favor, please raise your hand. Six in favor, the student rep abstains. Okay. I thought, you know, we were to school board updates and we haven't set the committees, and I could, you know, have you have input and I could set a next meeting, but I just wondered how many people are willing to stay on the committees that they're on. Does anybody want to switch? Does anybody want to switch? Kenny doesn't want to switch either, he talked to me, so. So what if we just assume that the committees will stay the same for this year? Are we okay with that?
Yeah.
Okay, that makes it easy, right? Okay. Maybe could I have a motion just to approve that the committee membership will be the same this year as it was last year? Al?
I'd like to make a motion to continue the committee assignments as they were from last year for the 2016-2017 year.
Moved by Al, seconded by Dan. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Six in favor. That was easy. Okay. Are there committee updates? Maria?
Not a committee, but and 68 Hours of Hunger is at present serving 27 kids in the system. And raising money and having a lot of food drives. Okay. And I can't tell you what wonderful people work for this, to make this happen. Lugging the food back, organizing it and distributing it. Mm-hmm. Next year's citizens of the community. And it's not me. I'm just reporting.
Mm-hmm. You've done a lot for it. Even my master's swimming team is doing work for. We're having a swim meet to raise money.
Cool.
For it. Yeah. Yeah. Other committee, Dan.
It wasn't an official
middle school building committee meeting, but there were some exploring all the possibilities for what to do with the current middle school. There are some new drawings as we explore the possibility of building a new middle school that were delivered today. And Dr. Morse, feel free to jump in and add anything to that. But again, the committee did not meet, but we did have an opportunity to just briefly look at some of the drawings.
Yeah, thanks, Dan. The architect was on site today with concept drawings. He's also studying K through 8 configurations and other variations of how we might address our needs at the middle school. So today he was sharing concept drawings with the staff and getting feedback from them.
Great. Can I say something? Superintendent and Kenny and myself watched whatever they called computerized the presentation months ago on how to pass a building bond issue. And it worries me that this has gone this far without input, constant input by the community to get consensus, to get input, you know, buy-in, because this is going to be a huge bond issue, and I hate to think that it's going to take us 20 years to get it passed. So I was hoping that we could find that online and watch it again, and as many of us as possible. Mm-hmm. And I know superintendent has looked into it and that it's really pretty expensive to have them do it for us. But there was so much to learn about how to go about getting the community input. This was a small town out in Colorado, I think, or someplace. But they ended up with having input, constant input from 5,000 community members. And if we can do something similar and have them be committed to this at this point instead of having it sprung on them at the end, this is what we have decided that you are going to vote on, to have them buy in and feel that this is a community effort to develop what they're going to vote on. So I asked the chair and the superintendent to look into this and maybe have this presentation again for more of us.
I definitely think that the information about the deficiencies in the building need to be broadly understood in the community, because that was a shocking information that we have. I don't think that's been broadly, the community's broadly aware of that. I think that's something we should talk about. That may be something for the communications committee to organize, you know, to organize. And we, you know, we talk about a lot of forums, but I mean, I think we're gonna have a busy year, but I think that definitely has to get out there, because it's a huge.
And I think language is important. They had had 4 or 5 bond issues that had failed before. And it was changing the language because people were concerned about safety. So then, you know, the presentations changed to safety rather than, you know, we can't teach in this building.
Yeah, yeah.
So I think it's important that we start right now, please.
I think it's a terrific suggestion, and we will take it up.
Thank you.
Other committee information updates? Okay, public comment? Okay.
Bob Barth, Lee, this will be less than 30 seconds, just to fill in 2 quick points in my screed. One is that many communities across the country are trying to drop football or switch to flag football only. Almost impossible once a program is established. We now have the huge advantage of not having football and thankfully do not yet have the problem of getting rid of it. Secondly, I may be wrong, but were this proposal put the referendum as it should, I doubt it would be approved by this community. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. Dean?
Hi, I'm Dean Rubine from Lee. I wanted to thank the superintendent for putting me on the principal committee. It's an honor to serve. And congratulations to the superintendent on getting his contract extended. Also, congratulations to the new and old chair, Tom.
Thank you.
On your re-election, and to Denise for getting to be vice chair, and for Al to get on the Durham Town Council. And I hope, even though the third candidate for the school board wasn't elected, that the board will still stand against Lyme disease.
I will.
A little inside baseball. Yeah. David Taylor from Durham. In the discussion you had about the middle school building committee, I looked on the website to see if there was a notice of that meeting, and I didn't find any. I don't know if it wasn't noticed. Since it now has a member of the board on it, it sounds to me like it's a public advisory committee and should probably be a public committee.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
I'm Tyler, and I'm from Lee, and I just wanted to say that to have football for middle school is, like, one of my favorite sports, and when I'm sitting in class, I can, like, know that when I'm done with school, I can go to football practice. And one of my favorite periods is lunch and recess. It's not for lunch, but it's for the idea that every day I get to go outside and play football. And sometimes we make a football game on the blacktop if it's like there's snow on the field and we can't go over there. And sometimes we have teams that are like 25 or more against 25 or more. And I just wanted to say that it's a honor to have all my friends, like, be able to play with them for a sport that I love.
Thank you.
Krista Butts, and I still haven't moved. I still live in Lee. And I just want to acknowledge and appreciate all of you for thanking the kids for being here tonight. It was really difficult for a lot of them to get up. I know the stigma for football is that they're all like pompous, you know what's, but really these are good kids and they have really good hearts and they were scared to death to get up here and speak in front of all of you tonight. So I really appreciate you giving the time to them because it took a lot of courage for them. It took them 6 weeks, as long as we've been talking about this thing, to say, okay, yeah, this time I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna actually stand up, I'm actually gonna speak. So I'm hoping to get a few more of them for next time if they want to, but I really appreciate you giving them the time and the patience because it took an immense amount of courage for them to get up here and speak to all of you, so thank you.
Thank you, Krista. Other public comment?
Okay, the future meeting dates are down here.
Can I slide one thing?
Sure.
Just because we don't have anywhere to put this. I know we did the full-day kindergarten registration. Can we get an update on those numbers?
Yeah.
Sure. I can give you the latest numbers that I know, which were the end of last week, and we had 51 registrants at Massway and 48 at Moheramet. So that pattern of Lee having more children than Moheramet at kindergarten right this minute isn't now in its second year. But I would caution the board that there are students yet to enroll that we don't have in terms of schedule, but who will appear at some point because this is still March. So right now we're in the ballpark for both schools and the projections we made, but I wouldn't hold my breath too long on that. Three kids in Massway and you know, seven kids at Mohairamit could show up by the time we end the school year.
Good to know. Denise?
Just for a future agenda item, I would like to see, I know that the middle school has looked at, you know, has been kind of doing a pilot of the competency-based reporting, and I'd like to maybe put that on the agenda for an update on how that's gone. And also, I know I mentioned this before, but for those of us who don't have access to seeing those report cards, if we could please get a sample as part of that so we could actually see what it is that the parents are getting.
I would say not just the middle school, because my understanding is there's been a modification of the elementary school.
Not since we did it 3 years ago.
Okay.
Yeah. But we can make sure the board has copies. That's not a problem.
Okay.
And I don't think that the actual middle school one has changed much.
As far as the report cards go?
Yeah. Oh. Okay. I'll fifth grade for sure, because that's part of K-5.
I'm looking, seventh grade math is now reported at 1-3.
Yeah. Okay, we'll make sure you get everything.
Yeah, great. Okay, I think we're ready for a motion to adjourn. Maria?
So moved.
Moved by Maria, seconded by Dan. All in favor, raise your hand. 7 in favor, the student rep in favor, we're adjourned.